What is the structure of commercial silicon solar cell that we want to make? So this lecture is mainly about the fabrication technology. How do we fabricate solar cell? So what is the cell structure that we want to fabricate? Yesterday, remember in the design, we have discussed about it, cell structure to fabricate. Okay. So what do you want to fabricate? We want to have a texturing, we want to have the anti-reflective coating, we want to have the junction, we want to have the back surface field, we want to have the back metal contact, we want to have the front metal contact. These are the various things that we require in our solar cell, right? So as we discuss, we will have the texture, and then we will have the emitter. Okay, we will also have our anti-reflective coating. Okay, then we will have our, so junction is here, then we will have our P side, this is my N side, this is my N plus, by the way, this is my ARC, and I have P plus, then I will have the metal contact here and metal contact here, and I have the metal contact at the back side. Okay, so this is the most simplest structure that we can have for a solar cell. Okay, this is the most simplest structure that you can have solar cell. The question is how to fabricate. So when we start, your starting wafer is flat. Okay, this is your starting wafer. Typically, your starting wafer is P silicon. Okay, that's it. It is a flat surface, and you have to process this. You have to process this wafer to get this structure. Right? You have to process this silicon wafer, which is a flat, to get this structure. How to do it? That is the question. So I will tell you a generic process what happens in industry. Okay, so the standard process that you start with your wafer cutting. Okay, normally you buy this wafer, so people buy this silicon wafers directly from the market. Okay, so this comes like this. So this is your starting point. Okay, your silicon wafer is your starting point. Doping of your silicon wafer is already predetermined because you buy your wafer as per the doping requirement. The next process that you do is normally to texture it. Okay, first of all, we have to clean the wafer also because it is coming from the sawing. Right? Remember when you saw your wood, the surface of the wood will not be very smooth. Right? There will be a lot of chips of the wood that will be sitting there. Similarly, when you saw your silicon, the surface will not be perfectly smooth and clean. There will be a lot of silicon chips will be sitting there. So you have to get rid of that, and moreover, you need to get a structure, you need to get a texture. Okay, that is the pyramidal form that you have to get. So that is the very first step that you do. Okay, so once you do the texturing, what happens? Your plane surface, which was like this, now gets textured. Both the front side and the back side like this. Okay, and this texturing automatically happens. I told you other day that if you take any silicon wafer and put in the NaOH or KOH solution, heat it at about 80 degree centigrade key for 5-10 minutes, you will see that preferential etching of silicon occurs, and I will discuss how it occurs. So what is the next step you want? Next step you want to is to make a junction. Your next step you want to is make a diffusion. So next step is your POCl3 diffusion. Basically, your starting wafer was P type, so now you want to make a junction of N type, and this junction is very thin, 300 nanometer, 200 nanometer, 400 nanometer. Your silicon wafer is thick, 180 micron. The doping level of silicon wafer, as we discussed in the design, is about 10 to the 15 to 10 to the 16 per centimeter cube. Now, we want junction to be at only one side, right? But how, what industry people do is they put 200 wafers together, 300 wafers together in a big furnace and expose it to the phosphorus containing gas. Okay, you expose it to the phosphorus containing gas. So what will happen? This phosphorus will containing gas will actually go everywhere. So when you are doing in the, when you are actually doing in the, so what you do is take many wafers, you take a board, and these are all your wafers. Okay, and this you put inside a furnace, and you pass the gas. You pass the gas which is having phosphorus atoms. What will happen? The phosphorus atom will actually deposit everywhere. So as a result of that, what will happen? As a result of that, what will happen? Your emitter is everywhere. Okay, your emitter is everywhere. But that is not what we want. What we want? We want emitter. What we want? We want emitter to be here. N plus layer, the heavily doping of N layer to be only at the front surface, not at the back surface. So that is one of the problem that we must overcome, or industry must overcome. So emitter gets here. Another problem, it is actually shunting everything, right? So one thing that people do is isolate this. So you cut this edges, actually cut the edges. Again, you have to, if you are using 200 wafers, you have to cut the edges at 200 wafers, okay, all the four sides you have to cut. And typically in industry, any given industry, you make 2000 to 3000 wafers per hour. Okay, what is the speed of the process? 2000 wafers to 3000 wafers per hour. So you have to actually cut the wafers of that many numbers. So there is very, very interesting way in which people do that, but you have to cut it. So I am just showing you that you have to remove the, what is called the parasitic junction. So you have to remove the parasitic junction. So you actually get cut from the sides. So your junction is removed from the side now. Still your backside junction is a problem, right? So what is the structure right now? Top layer is N plus, middle is P, backside is again N plus, right? What is the structure that we want? N plus, P, P plus. Okay, the structure we want is, we want top layer N plus, then we want P, and then we want P plus. That is what we want. What is the right now? Top layer is N plus, middle layer is P, and the bottom layer is again N plus. So we have to actually go from here and get this. How to do that? So this happens automatically. Now what next we want? We want to actually deposit anti-reflective coating. Okay, we want to deposit anti-reflective coating. So you do, what is anti-reflective coating that we use normally? Silicon nitride, okay, Si3N4 in the stoichiometric form, or normally SiNX. Silicon nitride is what we want to deposit. That can be deposited only one side. So typically it is a blue in nature. So you can see here the silicon nitride is now blue in nature. So silicon nitride is deposited next. Okay. What is the next step? You want to have the metal con. One problem to be solved is this, right? Backside you have N plus, but we want P plus. So that has to still be solved. The next step is actually to print metal contacts, front metal and the back metal. So actually do the screen printing, you put your metal at the front side, you put your metal at the back side. But there is another problem here. Another problem is that your anti-reflective coating, which is silicon nitride, is a dielectric layer, right? Dielectric layer means it does not conduct. So your metal contact is not in contact with semiconductor, and that is a problem, right? So what is the situation right now? You have okay, so this is your ARC layer, this is your N plus layer, and then you have P here. Where is your metal sitting? Your metal is sitting on the top of ARC. Okay, but this is your semiconductor, this is your metal, and in between you have the dielectric layer, okay, non-conductive layer. So which is not, it will not work. Because of this, your series resistance will be very, very high and your performance will be very poor. So what we want metal to come down and make a contact with, we want metal to come down and make a contact with semiconductor, with N plus layer. How we can do that in industry? How we can do that in industry? There is a process called contact firing. By the way, what are these metal contacts which you are using? What are these metal contacts which you are using? This metal on the top is actually silver plus aluminum. Okay, there is a small percentage of silver. Mainly it is aluminum, and the back side, the back contact, the back side we use, the back metal contact is aluminum. Okay, there is a reason for that. Aluminum makes very good contact with P surface. Okay, so you get good contact. Aluminum does not make contact with N surface, no good contact. But silver makes good contact with N-type surface, good contact. When you say good contact, we are talking about ohmic contact. Okay. silver N is good, aluminium P is not, is also good, but aluminium N is not good. So on the top you have N surface and a, if you actually only use aluminium you will not have a good ohmic contact. So then you have to use silver, but you cannot use 100% silver, right? It will be very expensive, solar cell will become expensive. So therefore people mix silver aluminium, and silver does the interfacing job and then aluminium can take care. So that is why the front surface contact is basically this, the back surface contact is this. So now one of our problem is that this metal contact, there is a dielectric layer sitting in between. What to do, what to take care, how to solve this problem? So what people do is what is called the contact firing or co-firing. In the contact firing, what will happen, this metal at the front side, actually when you heat it up, okay, when you do the heating, when you do the heating of this contact, this, because this layer is very thin, right? How thin is this layer? Only about 18 nanometer. Because this layer is very thin, when you heat it up, the metal gets actually diffused inside the dielectric layer and makes a contact with semiconductor. Another nice thing happens is aluminium at the back side. Aluminium comes from the which part of the periodic table? Aluminium is a trivalent impurity. Trivalent impurity, okay. What does it mean? For silicon, if any impurity atom is a trivalent, what does it mean? It will be acting as a p type or n type dopant. It will be acting as a p type dopant, okay. So when we do this heating process, when you do the heating process, aluminium also diffuses from the back side. Aluminium will diffuse from the back side. So you know, back surface is our n plus surface, right? Because of this emitter, back surface, the yellow one is n plus surface, but now aluminium will diffuse, and aluminium is acting as a p type, so it will actually overcome that n surface and it will make it p surface, okay. So this n surface that you can see here at the back side, when you do the contact firing, when you do this high temperature process, the n surface at the back side actually gets automatically converted into the p surface, remember. So now it has become the green layer, okay. Earlier it was like this, now it has become the green layer. And what has happened, remember, the metal contact were not in contact with semiconductor. After the firing, two things are happening. The metal contact is coming closer, if you can see it clearly, okay. Now the metal contact is making through and it is connected with semiconductor. And backside, where there was a yellow layer which was the n plus layer, has now become a p plus layer, okay. It has become a p plus layer. So what is this now? You have the n plus here, you have the p here, and you have the p plus here, and that is what is the structure we want. And we also got the anti-reflective coating, that is a blue layer, and then we got the metal contact at the front and metal contact at the back, right. That is the cell structure we want. So this is the typical solar cell process that happens in industry, okay. And finally you get like this, you have the backside textured, you have the p plus at the back which is very thin, your p is very thick, you have n plus at the top, you have the metal which is normally having aspect ratio of less than 1. So width is higher than the height. Typical spacing 1, 2 millimeter, 3 millimeter, okay. So let me show you this process, whole process again, just I will go very quickly through it, okay. So you start with the silicon wafer, you do the texturing, you do your junction formation, then you cut from the sides, then you actually put your anti-reflective coating, then you put your metal contacts, then you do the contact firing, and your solar cell is ready, okay. So this is what is the industrial process, and if you do this process well, very easily you can get a solar cell of about 15% efficiency, okay. If you do this well, very easily you can get a solar cell of about 15 to 16% efficiency. But I told you that laboratory solar cells, people have demonstrated, is very high efficiency, okay. So in the laboratory silicon cell, people have demonstrated efficiency of about 25%, okay. Commercial silicon cells, people have obtained the efficiency about 15-16%. Why so much is the difference between the laboratory cell and the commercial cell? There are many processes which from the design perspective we want, okay. There are many processes which from the design perspective we want, but we cannot implement in the industry because of the cost reason. We cannot implement that in industry because of the cost reason, and therefore the efficiency of the commercial silicon solar cell is always lower than lower than the laboratory efficiency, best laboratory efficiency that has been demonstrated. So there are many features we want. We do not want high recombination at the surface. So in laboratory, you can take special care for that. No, we do not want high recombination at the back surface. You can take special care for that. We actually want two anti-reflective coatings so that we can minimize the reflection at two different wavelengths, and things like we want high aspect ratio. So we want finger widths to be small and height to be higher. We cannot do that in industry and so on. So there are many compromises that industry we make. And therefore, our efficiencies are always lower in industry as compared to the lab. Okay, so now I will take you through the processes one by one so that you get a feel of it, how it is done and what temperature it is done. Okay, and I will come to the question answer soon. Okay, so first process is choice of wafer, and it comes from the design. So choice is about 10^16 atom per centimeter cube. So that is your starting wafer. Then you do the texturing. Okay. We have not discussed the orientation about the silicon atoms in a solar cell, but actually when you look at the crystalline silicon wafer, the atoms are nicely arranged. So when you look at the silicon wafers, atoms are nicely arranged, right? And based on the arrangement, you can actually define the directions in the silicon wafer. So if you look at from one side, it looks like this. So these are the house silicon atoms. So if you look, so normally the starting point is the direction called 100. We don't have time to discuss it that. But if you look in this direction, you get the direction 111. Okay. So when your starting point is 100, the density of atoms in one direction is different than the density of atoms in other direction. Okay. Same thing you can see if you have a systematic arrangement of chairs. If you look at the systematic arrangement of chairs in the classroom. And if you look from different directions, you get the different, you get to see the different views of arrangement. Okay. Same thing is true with the silicon atom. So when you do the etching of silicon, normally the, because the density is lower in 100 direction as compared to 111 direction, the etching is faster in 100 direction. Etching is faster in 100 direction as compared to 111 direction. Okay, just imagine right now that 100 is one some kind of direction in the crystal. 11 is another direction. In 100 direction, the density of atoms is lower, and therefore etching is faster. And in 11 direction, the density is higher and etching is slower. That what happens when I expose. In 100 direction, in this direction, the etching becomes faster. In this direction, etching is slower, and therefore you automatically get the formation of the pyramidical structure. You can use actually both acidic and alkaline solution. Typically, industry use alkaline solution. Potassium hydroxide and sodium hydroxide is commonly used for doing the texturing. Very easy process you can do, and this is why finally what you get, right? I showed you yesterday also when you are doing the etching, you get the pyramids formed. Okay, you get the pyramids formed like this. Okay, then next process is junction formation. How do you make a junction formation? Junction formation occurs by the diffusion process called diffusion. And as I showed you, you put many wafers together in a furnace. If I have the picture, okay, many wafers together, and the atoms of the dopant has to go physically inside the wafer, right? Atoms of the dopant has to go physically inside the wafer. So when you are doing the doping, okay, so your phosphorus atom is sitting here. So phosphorus atom must go inside. Okay, it must travel inside and occupy some space. Okay, so this is a physical diffusion of atoms, and therefore somebody was asking why to choose only phosphorus, why not other? And we have to worry about the size of the phosphorus atom. Okay, if the size of the phosphorus atom is too big, it will have difficulty in going through. If it is too small, it will also create a defects. Okay. Now, because this motion is occurring physically, you require high temperature. Okay. So doping, you require high temperature, and this temperature is normally between 800 to 1000 degrees centigrade. Okay. 800 to 1000 degrees centigrade, you need to dope, then only carriers will move. Second problem is the doping is not uniform. Okay, why it is not uniform? Because when your starting point, your P surface is like, this is the doping level, but when you are doing the diffusion, your, and first of all, emitter is heavily doped, right? Emitter is heavily doped. So when you are doing the diffusion, you have this motion. So in time and temperature process, your emitter is like this. And I'll show you again how, what we mean. So when we start the doping, I'm plotting the concentration. So this is my concentration and this is my depth, okay. So my starting is a P silicon. P silicon is normally 10^15 to 10^16 per centimeter cube. When I dope, my emitter is heavily doped, right? We have seen already, because we want low resistance from the emitter. We want low resistance from the emitter, and therefore doping level has to be higher so that conductivity is higher. So your doping is like this, but atoms are actually entering from the surface. So they will enter, so most of the atom will appear on the surface and then slowly they will go in, okay. So doping will look like this. So your N layer, okay, your N layer or N plus layer actually will have the doping of 10^18 to 10^19 atoms per centimeter cube. So this is your P layer and this is your N layer, and wherever you have the N layer and P layer meeting, concentration meeting, that is your junction. So okay, this becomes your junction. Okay, so this is how it looks like, and this is how you get, and it happens at high temperature, 800 to 1000 degree centigrade, and the time normally takes is 10 to 60 minutes. Okay, and the depth of the junction, what is the depth of the junction? Your junction forms here, your junction forms here. So this is your depth of the junction. So junction depth is, as I said, 200 to 500 nanometer, and this thickness of your wafer is very large, okay. This thickness is 180 micrometer. So as compared to 180 micrometer, the junction depth is very, very small, nanometer, okay. Okay, fine. There is a theory behind the diffusion, how it takes place, and there are whether the source is constant or it is limited, and what will be the profile of the diffusion will depend on the temperature and time, okay, two of the important parameters, what temperature you are doing your diffusion and for what time you are doing your diffusion, right. Right, so if I'm doing the diffusion, if I do for 10 minutes, it profile will like this, if I do for 20 minutes, it like this, for 30 minutes like this. So as I increase the time, the more and more dopants go deeper and deeper into the silicon wafer. So with respect to time, the profile keeps changing. This is the depth, okay. So time is important, temperature is important, okay. Temperature is required to do the diffusion. Normally, as I said, the temperature requirement is 800 to 1000 degree centigrade. If you do your diffusion at 400 degree centigrade, you may take some couple of years actually to get your junction. So temperature is also very important. So therefore, this graph is plotted for D and T. D is the diffusion coefficient, which is the function of temperature, and T is the time. And various impurity diffuse at the different rates. Various impurity diffuse at the different rates. Okay. For example, you see the diffusivity of boron is less, aluminum is higher, gold, which is not a desired impurity, is very high. Sodium, potassium, iron, copper, these are all the problematic impurities, right? These are all the problems for silicon solar cell. By any chance, if you have these impurities and if you are doing your diffusion at high temperature, you are going to get a, you are guaranteed to get a low solar cell efficiency. So for potassium, sodium, gold, iron, copper, silver, these are undesired impurity. This should not be there in silicon. If it is there, then you are in good trouble. Okay, so this is how you do the diffusion. You take all many of your wafers together. If you take many of your wafers together and you insert your gases inside. So dopant gas. Okay, if you are doing the phosphorus diffusion, then the phosphorus containing gate POCl3. If you are doing boron diffusion, then boron containing gas, that you have to do. And finally, edge isolation. You have to cut the edges. Remember, you have to cut the edges in order to avoid the shunting. How do you cut the edges? Which is done by what is called the plasma etching. So you actually put the stack of wafers together. How do you do the edge isolation? The process called edge isolation. Cutting the edges. What you do? You put many of your wafers together. You make a stack of 400, 500 wafers. So these are all your wafers, then you expose to the plasma. You expose to the plasma. How much material you have to cut? How much material you have to cut? You have to cut material equivalent to the thickness of the junction or the junction depth. What is your junction depth? Couple of 100 nanometer. Okay. So your junction depth is only 200 to 500 nanometer. So you have to cut very small distances, and therefore it can be easily be done with the plasma. Earlier people used to do mechanically also. Then people also do with the laser, but the plasma etching is the most common technique that is used. Okay. After that, the next step is anti-reflective coating deposition. Which material we want? We want silicon nitride, about 70 to 80 nanometer. The method that is used for silicon nitride deposition is PECVD, plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. Okay, plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. And this can be done in a one side way. So normally, what you do, you have your big chamber, okay, and all your wafers are sitting here. Okay, you want to deposit silicon nitride. So what you do, silicon nitride. So what you do, you put silicon silane into it, okay, and you also put ammonia into it. Silane and ammonia, and then you actually ignite your plasma. You ignite your plasma. So what will happen? These two gases will react, and actually will give you silicon nitride (SiN). And then this silicon nitride gets deposited, and this deposition will only occur at one side. And this kind of tool is called PECVD, plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. Plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. So it's some kind of chemical process that takes place between the two gases, silicon containing gases and nitrogen containing gas. Silane is a silicon containing gas, and ammonia normally used is a nitrogen containing gas. And the reaction of this two will give silicon nitride, which gets deposited. And I told you earlier also that the blue color of your solar cell, the blue color of your solar cell is actually because of the silicon nitride. Fine. So the silicon nitride is next, and how to design the silicon nitride, we have seen the square, the refractive index of silicon nitride should be square root of the layer which is above the silicon nitride and the layer which is below the silicon nitride. So you get a silicon nitride here. Remember the schematic, I am showing the flat surface, but in reality it is not the flat surface, it is textured surface. Another point of caution here is that all the gases that are used in the semiconductor industry are very dangerous gases. Okay, what are the gases we use? For example, when we want to make diffusion of phosphorus, we use phosphine PH3 or silane SiH4. Or when we want to make a diffusion of boron, we use diborane B2H6, or we use arsine for the phosphorus again. Okay. Look at the hazards. So these are toxic and flammable gases. Okay, toxic and flammable. What is the toxicity limit allowed? Parts per million. Okay. So arsine, for example, is one of the most dangerous gas. Its allowed limit in the atmosphere is only 0.05 parts per million. So in almost a billion parts of the air, their allowed limit is one molecule of the arsine only. If it is more than that, what it will do? It will kill you. So because it's all very dangerous gases, very toxic gases. You can see the allowed limit is in parts per billion, million and billion. So if you are using silane, if you are using phosphine, if you are using diborane, if you are using arsine in the laboratory, you have to be extremely cautious. Okay, and this is one of the reason why you cannot have these gases everywhere. Okay, again, nobody in India manufactures these gases, so whenever we have to do the processing, we have to import these gases even for the academic institutions also. So this is the point of caution. Then you do the metallization, front and back metal, and the last step is a contact firing. Okay. Metallization is done by screen printing. Screen printings are simple. You actually take your screens with the holes as per the pattern. What pattern we want? We want a bus bar, which is a thicker opening, and the finger, which is a finer opening. And your metal paste is kind of semi-solid. You do the printing as you do your business cards, okay, visiting cards. Same way you do the metal printing, screen printing of contacts also. Okay, so I'll stop here. I think that gives you very clear-cut idea about how solar cells are manufactured in the industry. Okay, starting with the wafer, you do the texturing, then you do the emitter formation, which is everywhere. So you have to isolate, then you do the edge isolation, then you deposit your anti-reflective coating, then you do your metal deposition at front and back, and you do the contact firing. So in a step by step process, I have shown you how the various processes are done. So now we have thankfully I could stop it 5 minutes before or 10 minutes before the official time allotted for this lecture. We'll stop here. I will take the questions on silicon fabrication as well as solar cell fabrication of silicon type, and in the next lecture now we will start, when I'll come next tomorrow, I will actually talk you about the performance of the solar cell and the module. First of all, we'll see how to design a module, okay, how to design a module, how many cells to connect and all. Once we do that, we should like at the performance of solar cells and module, and one of the last lecture will be how to design a PV system, okay. So if you want to design a PV system for your house or your college, then how to do that, okay. So let me start taking questions now. KG Somaya,
you have not mentioned about ion implantation in your slides. So is it used for doping in PV industry?
No, ion implantation is not used for the doping in a PV industry. It is an expensive process, not commercially viable for solar cell. But there are some people who are trying to do the research to get ion implantation in a specific manner when we want higher efficiency. But normally it is not used. VNIT Nagpur.
Etching of the texturing of the surface by etching in KOH solution. Mm-hmm. Is this possible only for 111 surface orientation or also possible for 100 surface orientation?
Normally the starting surface orientation is 100, okay. Now the etching will always occur preferentially in 100 direction as compared to 111 direction, okay. So if you are going to have the starting wafer as a 111, that you will not get the pyramids. Okay, because you are getting 100 as a starting, you get very nice pyramids. Okay, PSG College.
You told 100 is preferred to 111 orientation. Is it common for all type of silicons? I mean, crystalline, polycrystalline, or multicrystalline?
Okay, so when we come to the defining direction, the direction is only defined for monocrystalline silicon, right? Because in multicrystalline there are so many different crystal of different directions, it is not possible to give one particular direction for a multicrystalline, right? Remember, the multicrystalline silicon have all possible orientations, right? So in multicrystalline silicon, if I try to draw, you will have one crystal of this size, one crystal of other side, okay. So this is how the multicrystalline silicon look. Okay, now each of this crystal, this part for example has its own orientation, this part will have its own orientation, this part will have its own orientation, and so on. And therefore it is not possible to define a direction in a multicrystalline silicon. It is only possible to define the direction in monocrystalline silicon only. Okay, Tejpur University.
Why monocrystalline looks slightly blackish after the reflective coating, and multicrystalline is bluish type?
Why monocrystalline looks slightly blackish as compared to the multicrystalline, which is more bluish? One reason possibly could be because monocrystalline has the same orientation, it is possible to actually get the good texturing all over the surface. And multicrystalline silicon, because there are multicrystals, there are many crystals, each having different orientation, texturing of a multicrystalline silicon is, you listen to my answer first, the texturing of a multicrystalline silicon is not easy, okay, because every crystal has its own orientation, and therefore you may not get the best reflection from each of the crystal, and therefore some crystal will probably reflect more, and therefore it will appear little bit more brightish or more bluish as compared to monocrystalline.
Does aging affect the texturing?
Aging does not affect the texturing. Edging is what? It's a possibly the moment of atoms, but silicon is a kind of it requires a lot of energy to move any silicon atom. So once you have the texturing done, I don't think at the room temperature or even 100 degree, 200 degree centigrade, the silicon atoms can move. And if silicon atoms are not moving, which means it is not going to affect the texturing as a result of a time or age. Government College Salem.
Sir, while monocrystalline crystal pulling, in monocrystal puller, they rotate with some speed. Rotate the seed with some speed. How they fix the speed?
Okay, so when you are pulling the monocrystalline ingot from the melt of silicon, first of all, rotation is required because you want your impurities to be homogeneously distributed in the material. So that you know the concentration of impurity in your silicon ingot is uniform. Imagine the silicon ingot is normally about a meter or 1.5 meter long. Okay, so impurity concentration at the top of the ingot, middle of the ingot, bottom of the ingot should be same. So it should be uniform. The speed of the rotation then will determine the diameter of the ingot. Okay, so if you are rotating with a very slow speed, more and more silicon atom can get attached from the side also, and therefore the speed will determine the diameter of the ingot also.
For shaping the monocrystal, they are machined with lathe. Is it correct method?
They have to machine what? Monocrystal, the seed layer which is starting point of getting the silicon ingot will determine the monocrystalline probability structure of the vellore.
Sir, could you please tell us how to explain this fixed second law of diffusion? Means there is T and X both, so it's a three-dimension picture.
No, so normally fixed law. It's not three. We normally take it as a one-dimensional only, but there are two parameters. One is the space, and other is time. Okay. So as I plotted earlier, that when you draw the fixed second law, what will happen? If you are considering the concentration of dopants, okay, inside the silicon, and if it is your depth, okay, so for some time the doping profile will look like this, okay. So what is happening? Concentration and depth is changing with respect to time. At some other time you will have this profile. At some other time this is this profile. So in this way, the concentration is a function of x and time, both. Okay, so that is what is given in the fixed law. That how the depth and time both are changing. Like when we discuss the diffusion, when we discuss the IV equation of a diode, we said the concentration of carriers is changing with respect to space and as well as with respect to time, right? Same thing will also occur in the diffusion of this dopant, that concentration of dopant atom will change with respect to space as well as with respect to time.
So as we expose it for more time, the density will be more, on the gradient will be less.
No, as we expose it, the more at the surface concentration remains almost constant, but the atoms will have more and more time to go deeper and deeper, right? It will have more and more time to go deeper and deeper. That is what happens. Okay, MNIT Bhopal.
If we want to make a junction in the laboratory, should we follow the same process of phosphorus diffusion, or there are different processes which we can adopt?
Okay, if you want to make a junction in the laboratory, one way to do is a phosphorus diffusion. There are other ways also. There are much simpler ways also. For example, if you want diffusion, there are let's say I will show you phosphorus. So P diffusion, if you want. One way to do is POCl3. Okay, this is a, if you want phosphorus diffusion. One way to do is use a POCl3, okay. This is a liquid source, by the way. You have to kind of bubble it through the furnace. Other way is called spin on dopants, okay. These are the liquids which are available in the small bottles, and you can take your p-type silicon wafer, you can spin this dopant on your wafer and actually heat it up. Third way is to take a solid source, okay. So similar to wafer, you get a wafers of phosphorus containing. It is a solid piece of wafer. So what you do is you take your silicon wafer and you take your dopant wafer, okay, and then you put your silicon wafer and dopant wafer alternatively, so that and then you heat it up, so the diffusion takes place in the silicon. So there are other a couple of simpler ways also that you can actually use spin on dopant, which is much easier, and you can use the solid source. NIT Warangal.
So my question is, you have said that silicon wafer is manufactured using wire sawing operation. So, but the thickness is very less, or somewhere around 500 microns, as you have said. So can we get such very thin wafer using wire sawing? Can you throw some light on it, sir?
Yes, wire sawing, by the way, thickness is not 500 micron. I am repeating again and again, the commercial thickness right now we get is 180 micron only, 180. Yes, and yes, it is possible to get, not possible, it is actually done in industry to get 180 micron thin silicon wafer sawed by wire sawing. Yes, it is possible very much. And people are actually trying to go thinner and thinner, but once you go lower thickness, if once you go lower than 180 micron, I think somewhere the down the line about 100 micron or less than that, your silicon wafers start becoming flexible. Or actually the one problem why people are limited to 180 micron is that if you go to lower thickness like 150 micron or 140 micron, the handling of silicon wafer in industry becomes difficult. Why difficult? You know what I am talking about? I am talking about 2000 to 3000 wafers per hour production. So when your silicon wafer is thin, it becomes more and more difficult to handle it. But wire sawing technique, it is possible to get 180 micron and even less. Shastra University.
Good morning, sir. I want to know whether only commercial silicon solar cells are used in PV modules, or laboratory solar cells are also used, and why?
Laboratory solar cells are used in laboratory, not in commercial way. They are very expensive. They cannot be produced in a very large quantity and so on. Okay, so when people do the experiment in laboratory, they work with the 5, 10, 20 wafers. Okay, in commercial way, you are talking about, again, I am repeating, 2000 wafers per hour, and you produce millions of wafers. So laboratory solar cells are only for laboratory.
Hello sir, there is one more question. Whether we want to select a solar module, on which basis we can select either a monocrystalline or polycrystalline, which efficiency will be more for monocrystalline or for polycrystalline, or it is not considerable?
Lecture number 16 tomorrow. So wait for a couple of lectures, you will find the answer. Okay, NIT Trichy.
Sir, if nitrogen is useful in fabrication of solar cells, why you need to depend on that flammable and toxic gases? Nitrogen can also be used, no, sir?
Nitrogen, okay, nitrogen can also be used for, okay, so question is, nitrogen also be used for making the N-type instead of phosphine and arsine and other very toxic gases? The answer is no. You know, it is very important that diffusion takes place, it is very important that you get that any atomic form, it is very important that you actually affect your crystal lattice as minimum as possible, and it is not possible to do the same, get the same thing with nitrogen. So therefore, we have no choice than to use any alternative to the toxic gases. Okay, material of the bus bar is same as the fingers, same material, only thing the dimensions of the bus bar is thicker, the bus bar is thicker as compared to the fingers. Gandhinagar.
Sir, this is regarding doping concentration for boron. P-type wafers are available, so if we do the grading of the P concentration along the thickness of the wafer, so is it beneficial for the performance of the silicon solar cell? And second question, is such kind of wafer are available commercially?
Okay, so the point is very nice that normally the boron wafer is doped, is available with the constant doping. Okay, so when you take the boron wafer like this, and if I go from one side to other side, the concentration is uniform. Okay, so his question is, if we do not, if we have non-uniform concentration, is it useful? Answer is yes, it is very much useful, because if you create a non-uniform concentration, you can create an electric field, and that electric field can actually be useful in collecting more and more minority carrier. But imagine that I am actually doing a dope, I am doing the whole ingot, right? If this is my ingot, and I told you this ingot is 1 meter long. Actually, in your tutorial, I have given you problem to find out how many wafers you can get from a 1 silicon ingot. Now, it is not possible to, you know, grade it, vary the doping concentration, right? You want doping concentration of a particular variation in each wafer. It is not possible, because you are making a ingot of a 1 meter length. So, in practice, that kind of doping concentration is not possible to get, but it is desirable if you, if there is any other nice technique which is low cost, it can be used. Okay, let me take a couple of questions from the chat. In solar cell, we are connected number of series and shunt resistance. For getting the regulated output, we have to calculate the current value by Ohm's law, but Ohm's law is applicable only for constant temperature. In solar cell, we did not get the constant temperature. Is it applicable for Ohm's law in our solar cell? I am confused what you are writing. So, we will discuss maybe tomorrow in the following lectures what we are talking about, basically how the performance of cells and modules changes. So, that we will discuss. Shastra University question was whether industry started using CNTs for effective carrier collection. Answer is no, no industry is using CNTs for effective carrier collection. In fact, there are not many research lab also which are using CNTs for effective carrier collection. So, that is still a good research topic, you can work on it. How much energy is spent on producing 1 kilowatt of solar panel? Good question. So, 1 kilowatt of solar panel, the cost of this energy that is gone into manufacturing a panel is recovered in about 1 to 2 years. Okay. Now, 1 kilowatt of panel, how much energy 1 kilowatt of panel will produce? Again, we will discuss it, but I think roughly it about 3 to 4 or about 3 to 5 kilowatt hour of energy is spent in making 1 watt peak of module. Okay, 3 to 5 kilowatt hour of energy spent in making 1 watt peak of module. When we will do the system analysis, we can actually take this question. The answer is simple to find. You know, your 1 kilowatt peak module, if it is working for 5 hours per day, and if there are 365 days, this much is the energy produced. Okay, if you multiply by this, is the energy produced in 1 year. Now, I am saying that, let us say, if the payback period, what payback period I am talking about? Energy payback period. If energy payback period is 2 years, then you can say whatever is the energy comes, multiply by 2, that is the energy consumed. So, that is the typical answer, but we can look into the detail more. What are the minimum temperature requirement for converting from silicon to silane and trichlorosilane, dichlorosilane, chlorosilane respectively? Converting silicon to silane, we do not convert silicon to silane, we do opposite, we convert silane to silicon, right? We convert dichlorosilane to silicon, we convert trichlorosilane to silicon. The kind of temperature that is required is, again, you have to, you know, dissociate silane. So, silane SiH4 should get, so if you are doing it, your SiH4 should get converted into Si and some H2, okay. So, this process will require some temperature. This process will require some temperature, and I guess typically this temperature will be about 1000 degree, 1200 degree, 800 degree centigrade. So, this temperature will be in that particular range. So, you require some temperature to do that, okay. Okay, so thank you.